This episode of After Dark is brought to you by Audible. To try out Audible free, yes, absolutely free for 30 days, and to receive a free audiobook, all you got to do is that use that URL right there, audible.com/gamebreaker. E3 After Dark. What's up, everybody? I'm Gary Gannon. This is After Dark episode. I have no idea. E3 day one. I'm Gary Gannon. You're watching Gamebreaker TV, and joining me today, I'm sitting in the hot seat for Mr. Mike Shafted, who is, it's kind of bizarre because you're actually here. Well, no, you're not. Are you here? No, you're not here. What are you doing?
What? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm in the middle of something. Can you come back in like 5 minutes? I'm watching.
Sure, no problem.
Very exciting things. Just give me
this is a show called After Dark where we take live call-ins. That's right. The show is entire based around live call-ins, something people are afraid to do on the internet, but not Gamebreaker TV. We're all about it. So we take your calls, you ask questions, tell stories, whatever the heck you want to do. I imagine most of our callers today, hopefully, will be calling with something about E3, whether maybe what you're excited about, what you want to know we're excited about. I don't know, whatever you want to talk about or some of the news that's come out, because we just left the PlayStation.
So much of like you could just like, we don't even need callers. We could talk forever.
No, but
we need you guys to get us going. What do you guys want to hear us? Because I could literally talk about E3 for the next 5 hours.
Easily.
That's how exciting today was.
Easily. And I mean, to start things off, I think what really just kind of set things. I mean, we started off, we had the Microsoft. We had a bunch of keynotes today. We watched Microsoft. Then you had Ubisoft, you had Electronic Arts, but then really, really just what knocked it out of the park was at the end of the day today, the last keynote of the day, Sony PlayStation 4 just completely knocked
decimated.
It out of the park. Decimated.
They just decimated Xbox.
They X-boned the Xbox. They X-boned them. They just took it right in the rear. And we have a video, I understand, right?
Yeah. Well, we know we're having the problems. You know, Xbox has got a really lot of big controversy about trading games and letting your friends loan your friends your games. And PlayStation, you know, obviously there's a lot of concern and controversy. There's a little bit of some difficulty with it, so they wanted to make sure that they released a video that kind of broke it down for everybody, so that they truly understood how to loan games or trade games with friends.
Oh, I see. So the whole controversy, the whole thing about how Xbox is handling this situation and Sony and how you're actually going to be able to loan your buddy's games. So, okay, let's just get that up. I'm sure I'll understand a little more once I watch this. Let's check it out.
This is how you share your games on PS4. Thanks.
I died laughing when I saw that. It was punch after punch after punch.
They are
right
not
back
letting
to
up.
Xbox.
Like, I mean, oh, I got. I mean, since the last Xbox keynote a few weeks ago, or whatever, when they came out with television, and gamers just completely like flipped out, went sideways on them, and they got all that backlash. It was almost just like, you know, it was Sony's ready. They're ready, and they came and they didn't pull any punches. I mean, they went after Microsoft with every side jab they possibly could. Just, you know, no DRM. It's not always online. I'm not even going to get into the games yet. Sharing your games, being that simple, like not going to restrict you to
cheaper
sharing your games
by $100.
$100 cheaper, came in at a $3.99 price point, like. And then on top of all that were the games, just, you've been waiting how many years for Final Fantasy Versus? How many years?
That's probably, I think at E3 2006 is when they showed it, and it's been dark. Like, I scour the internet every 3 months just waiting to hear something about the development of this game, and just like crossing my fingers that it's still in development. There were so many people that thought it wasn't going to happen. And like I told you, I was about to wake up at the crack of dawn to go see this event just so that I could see the announcement of Final Fantasy Versus, which is now labeled Final Fantasy 15. And on top of that, like I always knew they weren't going to go into Kingdom Hearts 3 until they did Versus. Nomura is the director of both, and he specifically stated he wouldn't start on Kingdom Hearts 3 until Versus was completed. So I was expecting that. I was just expecting to hear about Versus. And then on top of that, he comes in and he's just like, oh, hey, by the way, which we knew it was coming. Obviously, if they're going to announce this, everybody knows this is next in line. But like, this was just like the icing on the cake. Like, they even had me, because I saw the trailer and was going through like all of the old games, and I was like, oh, this is just a Kingdom Hearts 1.5 trailer. Come on,
that's what everybody thought when it first kicked in. That's when it first kicked in. Everybody thought it was like, you know, because it said like recoded, and then all of a sudden it just said Kingdom Hearts 3, and everyone was like, what? Well,
the moment you saw Sora go HD, and then you saw this like massive wave of Heartless like chase after him, and it was just like, oh, so like I got chills. And everybody knows this is coming, and I could talk about these for days of how excited I was to finally get some little tidbits of information about these games. I'm super excited. But that has no bearing. I mean, this aside, that has no bearing on the fact that PlayStation just went for the jugular of Xbox. And
you know what's really crazy? You could say they went for the jugular, but at the same time, I think they just did really smart. They had really smart tactics. I don't even know if it's like they really went for the jugular. I mean, they obviously, Xbox, I think, just really came out with a lot of weird messaging on this one. It just like creeped people out. Like the first, you know, the last conference coming out, just like nonstop television talk, right? Like not even speaking to the gamer. And maybe that was their point, that they knew they were going to come back to E3 and they knew that they could like, you know, change the messaging up, and that's where gamers are really going to pay attention to. So then we'll talk to the gamers then. So maybe that was part of the plan. Okay. The Kinect thing was kind of a little bit of a disaster to them. The whole Big Brother thing, it's always on. But then it was like, you know, the non-sharing of the games, the DRM, the always checking in online thing. Like, all of these things that just have, like, kind of a bad undercurrent right now with the gamer community, like, really took hold. And it was like, I don't even know if Sony, like, really went for the jugular, or did they just make some smart decisions and they just said, you know what?
I think Sony's trying to stay in the market of the gamer. Like, they're not trying, it's very clear Xbox is trying to be this all-in-one hub for mm-hmm. your media entertainment, your television and everything. And a lot of gamers during Microsoft conference the first time around was like, you're forgetting about the gamer. And I think this time around, they definitely showed there's stuff in there for the gamer. They remedied that aspect at E3 this year, I think, easily. But obviously, there's still all of those undercurrents and under problems of what people didn't like about it. And we, as gamers, we're all like, why is this necessary? Why are you making us do this? Come on, this isn't gaming. Sony just basically straight up, and I don't think it's something that Sony could have had like changed in the process of hearing all this negative press at Microsoft. There's no way they could have been like, we need to completely reconstruct the way that the PlayStation is built, because this stuff can't be in there.
And that's my point about like why I say I think they've just made some really smart decisions. I think a lot of these decisions were in the pipeline for a long time. You didn't just like, you know, switch your entire thing when finally they you know, kind of put their messaging out there. So that's why I say it. But they are going for the jugular. I mean, like commercial. I personally love the humor that they're also having about it, and they're going for it, and they're just being like, because it speaks to people. It's like, who doesn't lend their friend a game, right? And it's like, in this day and age of like, you can't do that. Like, it's, I mean,
the amount of and it's another testament, the amount of uproar during those announcements, you know, no DRM, no, you can lend your game, et cetera, et cetera. Like, we didn't, I haven't heard those kind of like full stadium holler shouts for a couple of years at E3. Like, this was everybody in the room was like, I don't know if it was standing on a standing ovation or not, but everybody was just completely,
I don't know if they got one, but I've heard that they came very, very close. I heard when the DRM thing came up, I heard that it was very, very, very close to actually getting a standing ovation. We haven't even gotten into the games. I mean, and then so many games. It was funny because right before the PlayStation keynote, I was actually like, we were talking in chat, and I was sort of like, you know, I wonder if I'll buy a PS4. Like, I wasn't sure. And then, you know what? I was like, you know, there's one franchise on the PS, there's actually two franchises on the PS, like on the PlayStation, that I know that I love, and I love Metal Gear Solid and I love the Naughty Dog guys. So I knew, like, you know, getting probably another Uncharted is like a no brainer, right? So I like, I'm kind of like, all right, I'm probably definitely going to get one. But those were the only two things that I was like, all right, I'm kind of excited. Then this morning with the Microsoft keynote, it was Metal Gear Solid gets announced on the Xbox. And I was like, oh, there goes one of my reasons to possibly want to buy a PlayStation. But then the keynote happened, and I was like,
that looked beautiful.
Yeah.
Just stop for a moment and be in shock and awe of how open world amazingness.
Kojima's like on another level. Like, really. I mean, I hope for gamers that like that style of game, and I know it's not for everybody, but man, like the last Metal Gear was an amazing game. It's really on a different level. I mean, I know some of the things, like, I think maybe some people view as kind of like over self-indulgent, kind of like, you know, like there's a 40-minute cutscene in the last one. I mean, it's a 40-minute cutscene basically where you just like sit back and watch a movie. And I know for a lot of gamers are like, that's lame, I want to play the game, but I don't know. I personally love it. Like, I think he takes it to another level. But man, we can't even get into all the games. We have callers waiting on the line, but I mean, Destiny looked amazing. Couple of things that came out of nowhere.
I got some thoughts on Destiny. I'm hoping some people call about Destiny.
I do as well. I hope we can talk a little bit more about Destiny. I think we're going to have, during this E3 couple of days, I think if we don't get to everything on After Dark, we're going to be covering a ton of stuff at E3 over the next 3 days from the showroom floor. So be watching Gamebreaker TV. And if we have to, maybe, I don't know, we'll figure out how to do some like extended, long, special show if we just need to, like, you know, have diarrhea at the mouth for like 3 hours. Because I feel like this year it's going to happen. And I already...
This was a really good year. I gotta say, last year I was gypped. I was completely gypped. My sister got married, and I had to miss E3. But my first time going to E3, so excited to have this, and what a year to go. This is the year to go experience E3. I'm excited.
I think for the Game Breaker community, I'm gonna say possibly, but whether they're excited or not, I think it's a little bit divided right now. But I think the most mind blowing thing that's come out of E3 so far for the MMO gamer was Elder Scrolls Online being announced on the PlayStation 4. It's now been confirmed it's coming out for Xbox and PlayStation 4. So it's coming out PC, PS4, and Xbox. But we had not heard a word of this until the PlayStation announced it, and I think everyone's mind was blown. That's gonna be super interesting to start talking about over the next few months. For sure. Couple of side things that kind of blew me away. The Crew, car racing, basically car open world car racing. Seems like an MMO.
Okay, before we get to callers, because holy crap. Gaming is going to become so much more MMO than I think we're ready to realize, and the lines are going to be blurred. The Crew, what was it? The District? Like these games that are open world and like
The Division.
The Division.
No, it's a pretty, like, it's a pretty hard, The Division is kind of a lame name. It's kind of it's too easy, forgettable, and you keep messing it up. It is really, it isn't. It's not an awesome name.
I keep thinking District. Okay, because it was like a city district.
District 9, and I was like, yeah, I get it. But yeah, it looked, I mean, that's a, so what did you, I took away from that, it looks like a modern day, I almost want to say like DayZ-esque game, but not with zombies, with against other players, set in a modern world.
I think it's got AI in there. I mean, the zombies were the first group that they came up to. I'm almost positive that was like, cause they're like, oh, we got to go get this gun, you know, whatever. And that was like AI. That's like a multiplayer mission or whatever that they decided to go storm. That was an objective, but there were other people,
sure,
in the world.
DayZ has AI as well. DayZ has, has zombies and real players. What I'm saying is, like, I feel like it looks like to be that kind of a game on a console, like smaller groups of players. So where the world feels kind of sparse and empty, kind of like DayZ, where you're like scavenging and trying to like survive.
The one thing about it, though, can we just honestly say that was some of the most scripted and like awful, like no gamers like, oh, shot out your turret. All right, you need to move. Like, yeah, like get into it. Like that was so scripted. And I couldn't help but laugh.
I got to, well, I'll agree with you, and I'll also give a little dig on the Destiny thing. It was a little overdone. Like the whole, it was a little overscripted. It was a little canned, but all right, we should take some calls.
I'm so shamelessly excited to play The Crew, because it truly is like in a interactive Fast and the Furious MMO game, and it just looks so much fun.
Yeah. Like, I love car racing games. If
you go see those movies,
so good. I'm actually a huge fan of car racing games. I mean, Forza looks ridiculous, but I love car racing games. And there's, you know, Need for Speed, tried to do Need for Speed Online. It was pretty lame, so it never really worked. So I hope it works, man. I hope it's really good. There's so many. All right, we can keep going on. Hopefully, we're gonna get some calls that are gonna lead us into some other stuff. So
good conversation.
Let's see if we got on the call. Hey, you're on After Dark. What's your name and where are you from?
Hi.
Hello.
It's Omi Kins from chat.
How are you?
Hello. Obviously, you guys have watched the stream today. A lot of talk Non-stop. About that. So, after seeing both the Xbox One and the PS4 conferences, mm-hmm. are you on Team Xbox One or Team PS4?
What do you think after that whole intro? I mean, what team are you? I'm pretty sure that Mike and I are both on Team PS4 right now, but yeah. What where are you sitting?
I'm with PS4 as well.
What won them over? Like, what was, if you had to pick one thing, like, what was the thing that came out in the keynote that really spoke to you as a gamer that you were just like, yes, they get me?
The first initial feeling I got was their direction towards indie games, because I saw Oddworld pop up and I was like, yes, I want to play that again, because that was one of my favorite games growing up.
Yeah, it was interesting that they spent like a whole little segment of the entire keynote just kind of highlighting indie game developers and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And again, super smart, right? Because we're like in that mode of indie is like the new hotness. It's like the music industry. It's like big, huge rock bands don't exist anymore. It's all about indie. And same thing with game developers. They're creating great stuff. So what was the other big indie game? It was what's his name? The GameSpot dude who now runs Supergiant Games. Bastion.
Yeah, the new Bastion game. I forget what that was called.
It was hard to fully understand what was happening there, but knowing those guys, because it was the Bastion dudes, it's probably going to be awesome. But I am completely on... you know what? I shouldn't say I'm completely on PS4, because I know I'll probably have both consoles.
I'm not going to... Yeah,
but I'll end up with both. The PS4 just won me over. The keynote had me like almost ready to like jump out of my seat and want to cheer for them.
It's that exact situation. I think I've always been one to get both, to invest in both consoles, just to have them just in case. Obviously, I don't want to shell out $900 right at the launch day if they launch within the same period of time. But based on the cheaper price tag, all of the features that you know, kind of diss Xbox. These two things right here. There's Destiny. There's so much going on with PlayStation that for me it's an inescapable pass. Like I will be upset if I can't get that on launch, and I will stay up all night outside of GameStop if I have to.
I mean, even this week, like this coming Friday, right? I mean, I'd be honest, I haven't, my PS3's not even completely honest, it's not even hooked up right now. It's sitting in our back room in the storage room, dusty. And I can't wait to this Friday, because even The Last of Us comes out from Naughty Dog, which I'm super excited. I mean, getting like 100s across the board and like insane remarks, but that's either here or there. So I just, yeah, they really got it, you know, and I don't have to have that creepy camera always on watching me in my house, which is probably super important as well. What time, you know, what's interesting? What timing too, right, Meg? Like, you think about it, like, you guys are following the news. What's the news? But if you're following the news right now, what's really funny is you've got all this NSA stuff going on with this whistleblower, you know, Snowden coming out, like talking about what the NSA and the government's doing, and Obama. And then you've got the whole Google Prism thing. I don't know if you looked at that last week, where like they're talking about, they're showing how like, you know, the social networks like Google and Facebook are all tapped into the CIA, and they're like, you know, they're basically collecting all this information. Sidetrack of a note of what a bad time for Xbox to come out with something that's a camera on all the time. It's on everybody's mind, right? We're reading it in the news. We're reading about like Big Brother, and like they're watching you, and there's cameras everywhere, and they're like, and it's going to be on 24/7 and check in all the day, and it's going to be listening to every word. So that's like terrible for them. On the flip side, what perfect timing for Watch Dogs, right?
Like,
Like, you couldn't ask for a better moment in like history almost than to have a game like this, because it's like, wow, it's like you want to play the game that you're almost sort of like living. It's like the next step of what you're living in right now.
Watch Dogs is one of those games I'm also excited for the same reason I'm excited for Grand Theft Auto, because it's based in like LA. I'm really excited to see the landmarks and what they take and what I can actually recognize. Watch Dogs to another level, especially based on the detail that they're creating this game in. I'm interested to see Chicago, because obviously I'm from Illinois and I lived in Chicago for about a year. I don't know it as probably well as I know LA, but I'm still excited to kind of see the elements that they bring to life in the Chicago cityscape. So
it seems to have a very GTA feel kind of to it, with that sort of hacker espionage kind of, you know, vigilante-esque, but it looks like it's going to be kind of GTA-ish. All right, let's take another call. Hey, what's your name? You're on After Dark, and where are you from?
Hey, Gary, it's Rich from Breckenridge.
Hello, Rich from Breckenridge. How are you, sir?
All right, how are you?
Good, good, good. How's your first day of E3 going?
Oh, it's going well.
Excited?
Not particularly, because I'm not really a console person, although I did really, really enjoy Sony's just total punch to the nuts.
Punch to the nuts. There you go. What are you kind of not like? What were you sort of expecting something out of the MMO? I assume you're more of a PC MMO player.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm more PC. I'm definitely a PC player. I stopped playing consoles a long time ago. I just lost the desire to play them.
Are you a Witcher 3 fan? I gotta ask. Are you a Witcher fan?
Witcher 3 does look it's big pimping. I have to admit.
Big pimping.
Yeah, as a MMO fan, then I'm just gonna take it down this road, and we can talk about it later. What do you think of Destiny? Then is that something that piqued your interest as an MMO, or
I'm having seen so many MMOs coming out in so many years now, I gotta see more. It kind of glazed over for me. It didn't give me enough meat and potatoes to really know what I can get out of it yet.
Hmm. So what's your question?
Well, my question was really reference to this whole console boxing match that we're having right now. Why do you think companies like Microsoft make such piss poor decisions like the used game one? Are they ignorant? Are they just arrogant? Do they think they're like the banking industry, that they're just too big to fail and that the fans will just kowtow and fall in line and not bother to care? Are they just ignoring their game base? And by the same token, you know, clearly Sony is paying attention. So why is Microsoft just being this?
Microsoft,
every decision they made is negative. Everything is backwards.
I think Microsoft really trying to take a stance to revolutionize gaming. I mean, you know, look at the steps that the Wii took for motion controls. I think a lot of people, when they first saw that idea, maybe weren't receptive of them, and over time that changed. I think Xbox is looking, you know, at the potential of what these things can do, the integration TV to TV, and looking at how to make it a all-in-one entertainment platform. Not saying they're maybe trying to not be a gaming console anymore, but they're trying to transcend that and be an entertainment platform, hence Xbox One. And that, I think, is the road that they're going down, which is kind of causing these issues. Gary, do you have any other maybe...
No, I kind of agree. I think it's actually really a hard thing to probably piece together without like trying to figure out the chess game, without knowing like all the things that are going on in the back end. Like it's really hard to piece together possibly all the deals that Microsoft are doing with different entities and how they intertwine and how they dovetail with different things. And, you know, I think they all see that television is changing in a really big way. And I think that they see that this could be an opportunity to kind of like, over time, replace the set-top box and how you're actually consuming entertainment. And they may not really see anybody else going after that, right? Like, you don't see the PlayStation really, really pushing down that road. They're still, like, especially this year, like, they're all about just making a console for gamers, right? Same thing with Nintendo. Like, they've got their place. Maybe, you know, maybe Xbox says, well, hey, they're okay with that, seeing that, like, hey, somebody needs to fill this hole because things are going to change. This is the way television is going to change. This is the way people are consuming media. And there are a lot of people who, you know, we can actually cater to and deliver a service to that's very different. I think they definitely kind of had some missteps with their communication this year and their marketing, though. I think that's the big thing, is that it came off at the wrong time. And like I said, I think stuff with like the camera and stuff, with some of the big points that people jumped on, is all about timing. It does feel like they're making a lot of really stupid mistakes. Like, it really feels like, especially when they're talking to gamers at an E3 conference, like the DRM, the not sharing, like the online, like all the things that gamers are grumpy about and will jump on forums and yell and scream about, they basically said like, hey, we're going to do all of them. Like, here's the checklist of everything you guys hate. And it feels like they're just being like, yes, we're going to do that one. Yes, we're going to do that to you. Yes, we're going to do that to you. Okay. And then we'll shaft you this. Okay. Bend over really hard, 'cause I'm going to finish this off. And
I don't know if I don't know the text of it. So I don't know if this is an absolute necessity or not, but I feel like at least the online features, I was actually watching the Xbox conference next to Flitz, and he did kind of made this remark of games like The Crew is potentially why they need to have that accessibility to check in and look at your game even when you're not playing. Or I think it was Forza, the one that said the game's going to kind of evolve, and basically your online carvatar, I think he said, or something of that nature, like it evolves over time and acts like real people. It needs that information based on the way that you know your game has been, and I don't know why that couldn't be stored over the internet or in a store like somewhere else, but that might be for features like that might be why we see Xbox needing to access the console every 24 hours.
I think the whole online, always online thing, if they could find a happy medium and do it correctly and also communicate it correctly, I don't think gamers would be as pissed off about it. I mean, I can see some benefits, like you said, The Crew is a good example of like why there might be some certain benefits to being online all the time. And let's be honest, now with this whole NSA thing, like they're tracking and looking at everything anyway, so who really cares, right? And we're pretty much always online. You got a cell phone, it's always online. You got a computer, you're pretty much always online. Where gamers get really pissed off is when like my game won't work if my internet goes down and I'm not online. And that's right. Where it's like, man, really? Come on. Like, you can't figure out a way that this is possibly workable, that I can play this game if my internet goes down or like in a storm or something. So then
what happens?
I don't know why they can't just find that happy medium of just being like, hey, look, we're always going to be online because we're going to check in and we're going to do these things, but look, we're not going to disrupt it. And if your internet goes down, you're still going to be able to play this game. You might not, you're obviously going to not get a multiplayer. Done.
What happens? Like, I know when I moved into this house that I'm in right now, you know, we didn't have internet for a week or two, and my only solace was consoles. So like, That's something that they do have to consider is that's going to cause a big problem for those situations.
I don't think the future like will be always online. I don't know if the world is ready for that, like fully on now and communicated. That's just like, it's the way it's going to be. Like, I feel like this generation of console, it would have been nice to have a buffer where it's like, hey, it's doing this thing and it's online, but you're going to be fine and play, you know, it doesn't have to, you know, if you lose your internet, you work. Maybe the next console, I don't know. It's just, it's bad mess. All right, let's take another call. Caller, you're on the line with After Dark. What's your name? Where are you from?
Hey, it's Ricksterness.
How are you, Ricksterness?
Rick, we're Ricksterness.
Ricksterian. Hey, just wanted to know, out of all the... I guess you're excited about that new video, huh?
We're all a little excited. It's day one of E3. We're pumped up. We're getting ready to go to the show tomorrow, so we're all pumped up. So what's your question?
Yeah, what was your favorite of all the new IPs that were announced today?
New IPs. Let's start with you. I want to know what yours is. What was your highlight?
I'm going to have to say The Crew. Just an online MMO racing game that you can like customize your cars. Oh, beautiful.
It's cool, right? I mean, it's kind of, and I think it was out of left field. I don't think anybody expected it. The Crew was definitely cool. I don't know if it was my favorite.
Ubisoft, I think. I think Ubisoft, out of the, I didn't watch EA's, but out of the games that came out of Microsoft, Sony's, and Ubisoft's, Ubisoft's the one that I finished watching, and it really blew me away. Obviously, I can't mention these. They're not UIPs, but I was going ape crazy when I was actually, quick story. Because I don't know if I'll ever get to it again. I was in the middle, like I was driving home, and I had the stream playing on my phone. And I was just listening to it, and all of a sudden they mentioned that Nomura was coming on. I almost swerved off the road and tried to find like the nearest spot to like park my car on the side of the road just to watch when he started talking about these two games. But instead, I know, like, because I was like 100 feet away from my house, and it's like, no, but I can't miss this. So like I paused it. I immediately like slammed on the accelerator and tried to get to my house as fast as possible so that I could like sit and focus. But like, Okay, so new IPs, Ubisoft. I gotta agree with you. I think the crew is really interesting. It's again, like I said, it's that kind of excitement over the top car racing, work with your friends. You know, Burnout Revenge was a game that I liked. It was one of the few racing games that I really liked because it was racing with a twist where kind of the whole entire, you know, point of the game was to wreck other cars. Now this is taking not only that idea, putting it in a massive open world U.S. environment. It feels 100% open world. I'd be very skeptical until I see it, that like you can literally have all this city in like LA and then New York's going all at the same time. You can drive from LA to New York without seeing a single load. If that exists, that's amazing, and I'm excited as no other for that.
Such a hard question. I'm trying to nail it down, and I'm just like, wow, we haven't even talked about Titanfall. I mean, looks awesome. Like, it looks so good. Witcher 3. Oh, wait.
Titanfall.
New,
Titanfall was
Witcher 3
the,
for everything.
Titanfall was the game made by, not Reboot. It was made by the Infinity Ward people, right? Restart. Yeah, it was the people that got kicked out of Infinity Ward, and that's their first game.
I think the cool moment for all of us was like it was like probably about three quarters of the way in. And your character, he like jumps up on top of the mech and then shoots the guy in the mech through the top hatch and then jumps
into
it. Oh, I was like, oh, this game's going to be awesome. Ah, there's so many. I don't even know. I don't know what I got most excited for. I guess the MMO player in me in a weird way, I don't know, maybe this is bad, but as far as new IP, what I'm probably still most hopeful for that I think is going to be really solid, that I'm probably going to really enjoy, is probably going to be Destiny. Even though I was slightly let down by the presentation. I expected a little bit more out of it, and there wasn't like this jaw-dropping moment. But at the same time, when I step back and I've been thinking about it since I watched it like a few hours ago, the atmosphere and the setting and where it was and how it kind of played out through what they actually showed with gameplay for the first time actually gets me really excited, because I can imagine with me and like three or four of my buddies like jumping on at night and like playing a game like that and kind of going through that, and I think I'd really, really like it. But there wasn't like this, oh my god, like I can't believe this game is doing that moment.
Can we go down the Destiny game road in here just real quick?
Sure, I've got all night.
I mean Destiny was one of those games. I was watching it really kind of excited to see what they were going to do with it. And at face value, to me, it really felt like a more open world immersive co-op experience that you would expect from, say, something like Borderlands.
Mm-hmm. That's what everyone's comparing it to, yes.
That's what a lot of people are comparing it to right now. And I don't necessarily think that's a bad way, but has Bungie touted this as being an open world MMO? Or is this just what they're saying is their next project?
I forget the terminology that they're using, but they don't say it's like, you know, fully open world. It sounds like it's going to be like Borderlands-esque, with you and a small group of friends go out and do these things and these missions. There's a huge story arc, but it's going to have a lot of MMO elements. And I think it's going to be a little bit deeper than like Borderlands. And I also don't know if I see it being like a loot pinata like Borderlands, which is actually what I hate. Because I know a lot of people are going to like hate me for saying this, but I don't think Borderlands is actually that good of a shooter. Like, I don't think it's... I think they throw all that loot at you to, like, hide the fact that it's actually not a great shooter. And they're just like, here's stuff! More stuff and more stuff! And for people who love just getting stuff and, like, a gajillion guns, great. I'm not really that gamer. I like the atmosphere. I like story. I like going through, like, things with my buddies and, like, learning about the world. I like that.
I want something similar to that. I want like that dungeon that they went into. I want that to be something that like you could literally go in there and it's empty because someone already beat you into that area. That's kind of what Elder Scrolls said they're doing with their dungeons, not being instanced, and you can just go in and make it happen. You know, like when the big mech or whatever it was, the big ship came out of the sky, I was thinking like how cool would it be to consider the fact that someone was all the way over in that physical distance and saw that, you know, big ship come out of the sky and they're like, what is that? And it flies over that way off screen and they're just like, what was that? Like, I want to figure out what that was. But the people that were over in the area get to experience a really awesome event. Like, that is a living and breathing, exciting world that, like, has so much mystery to it of like, but it's just, it felt too much like it was scripted events and then had like multiplayer in.
I mean, for the MMO player, like we're like, again, we're the 1% of the MMO players that like, you know, we played a bunch of them and stuff like that. There was a lot of elements in there that we've kind of seen before, you know, coming out of the sky, it's Defiance, Rift, you know, that kind of thing, you know, public events. We've seen that for a long time in MMOs. So I think a lot of the sort of like things that we
got to see
in that demo, we've seen those mechanics and things done. I don't know.
But console players haven't. That's a really good point. And that's something that's probably going to blow away the average Halo junkie and really look at it and be like, holy cow, like this is the living and breathing Halo experience.
And now people just rolled up on this like thing and now we're playing. We were with 4 people and now there's like 12 people here. Like,
yeah,
that's crazy.
That's a really good point.
The thing is, it's Bungie, right? Like, it's the Bungie dudes. So it's like, I kind of think that some of the story and the atmosphere is going to be really awesome. And I'm kind of looking forward to maybe like a smaller, like sliver style MMO where I can be like, hey, let's jump on and do some stuff and then we can take a break. I don't know. But going back to the original question, I don't even know if I can pick one yet. I think it's too early to tell. I've got about a top three. It's not a new IP, but I'll probably just keep saying Witcher 3 over and over and over. Because they're probably my favorite company in the world. That's my take on it. I
got to go with The Crew or The Division. The Division? Yes. Because it's not District, it's remember. Division.
All right, let's take another call. Cole, you're on the Air with After Dark. What's your name? Where are you from?
Hey, this is Levi from Tulsa.
What's up, Levi from Tulsa? How are you?
Hey, I'm doing pretty well. How about yourself, Gary?
Good, good, good. What's your question?
You know, what can Microsoft do now to even the playing field? I mean, they can reduce their price to match the PS4, but as far as the design features they've already implemented and touted, I mean, how do they become competitive again? Can they change some of the unpopular features and still deliver by the holidays, or are they just screwed?
I still think they're going to sell a gajillion copies. I don't even know if they have to. Like, I think, you know, they got beat out in this keynote. I don't know. I still think they're going to sell a gajillion units. I think they'll tweak their messaging. I don't think they'll drop their price. I don't see them just coming out and dropping their price. I really don't think they're going to be that aggressive. I can't even imagine that. Like, I would be really, really, really surprised if a company like Microsoft didn't know the cost of what Sony was going to come out in their keynote. There's leaks, there's moles, there's people that will talk. I am almost sure that they knew how much that console was going to be touted for today at the PlayStation conference. I doubt they kept that a secret. I don't know. I don't know if they're really going to change. I think they're going to stay course.
They're going to have to address some of the concerns. I don't think there's any way that they can just be like, oh, this is how it is.
You think they're going to change those things, though? Like, you think they're going to come back and be like, okay, you know that online thing? Let's cut that. You know that camera thing? Let's cut that. You think that sharing thing? We're going to fix that. You think they're going to come back and actually make all those changes?
I don't know if it's necessarily a matter of cutting. It's just that they've got to do something. They do not have the popular vote at all at this point anymore. Gamers.
Did you get to watch the conference this morning? Did you watch the entire Microsoft one?
I got about halfway through, and then I had to start picking up on the Ubisoft.
What was your
one.
Feeling about halfway through? Just kidding, because when I finished the Microsoft conference, I actually felt that they actually did really well. Like, I thought that they did okay, and I was like, wow, they changed their messaging
until PlayStation came out.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Like, at that time, I was like, wow, they changed their messaging. They really did talk to gamers. Like, there was they were definitely talking to gamers and not about the TV stuff. They barely mentioned it. So I actually thought they did a good job. It's just the fact that like Sony just killed.
They're still gonna sell units, but I think that there's Microsoft fanboys, there's Xbox, there's people who I am a personal I despise, even though it's free, I despise the PlayStation Network's online capabilities. So unless that gets better, I would still prefer to pay for Xbox Live for their online games. But
I mean,
you know,
isn't Call of Duty
stuck.
Alone gonna sell like a gajillion Xboxes? Like, really?
Of course,
come on.
Of course.
One game alone is gonna do it.
It is not by any means in any sort of jeopardy for what it is. I mean, look at, well, no, I don't think the Wii had as bad of publicity. I don't think they'll straight up nix anything, but I think that they are going to have to kind of think through their strategy a little bit, because PlayStation knocked them out of the way. Again, like you said, right after the Microsoft conference, I was like, okay, you know what? Maybe, all right, I'll buy one. You know, I don't know if I need it right now. It's going to maybe depend on the games and when they're released. But, you know, I'll still get one. Sony's conference, I was like, okay, well, I know I'm getting a PlayStation first. I'll get an Xbox eventually, but I know day one I'm getting a PlayStation. So that's, I think, the only difference that they've created there is that some people are going to, like, people, I think people are just more in favor of the PlayStation right now.
All right, let's take another call. Caller on the line with After Dark, which name are you from?
My name is Brendan. I am from Trenton, Georgia.
How are you, Brendan? What's going on?
I'm doing great. I have a question that's not related to E3.
Shoot. You're probably the only one tonight, so go for it.
That's what I was thinking. I've been playing Marvel Heroes, and I went and read some reviews on it, and they're all horrible. Like, everybody's bashing the game. And the only thing I can see that's really wrong, that some of the stuff's a little overpriced in their cash shop. Although, it seems like a large majority of people just don't like the Diablo action RPG style gameplay in the MMO community.
I think
what was actually your question about it, though?
The MMO community in large, is the Diablo action RPG play style really that bad?
I don't think it's bad. I just think, like, Borderlands, like, back in my day, so when Gary was still 20 something,
last week.
The MMO, like Borderlands, is a good example, and obviously I think back in the day when video games were hard and not didn't have a lot of substance, but were based around complexity, loot grind games were very easily immersible. People didn't mind them. People were fine crawling dungeons for days for that random loot chance and just doing that repetitive process over and over and over again. And I think as games have developed and we've been given more options and more creativity and we've grown as a gaming community, I just don't think that style alone is able to hold a community. It didn't. The king, I think, that everybody will say of action RPGs is Diablo. I think that's fairly undisputed. And that didn't hold for very long. So, in my opinion, just because you grab Marvel and put it in the same kind of environment doesn't mean that it's going to resonate with every single comic book fan out there. It's still the same game.
I've been seeing mixed reviews on it. I think a lot of MMO players are trying it, maybe thinking it's like MMO-esque. We talked about it a bit, Mike Byrne, on our free-to-play show on Gamebreaker called Derpy Dragon. If you guys haven't checked it out, check it out. Last episode, we actually talked about Marvel Heroes quite a bit. I think he's still working on the review. It's going up soon on freetoplay.tv. He has some really good things to say about it. He liked it. What he thought, though, was, you know, that it's not much of an MMO. So I think, I wonder if a lot of MMO players are trying it, thinking it's going to have more of that multiplayer online MMO experience, and they get in there and it's not. Like the caller said, you know, there's certain gripes where people are complaining a bit about the cash shop. They've definitely done the right thing, apparently, in the cash shop, where there are no pay-to-win items whatsoever. So they've kind of gone down a good road there. Some of their stuff sounds like it might be a little pricey. Again, you can spend money if you want to. Like, that's your prerogative. Apparently, all the items in the shop are attainable in the game if you want to put the time and the effort in. But, yeah, I don't know. I haven't really been reading the reviews to see if it's getting really terrible reviews. I've actually been hearing somewhat good things about it, but I could see possibly how if you're coming at it from an angle thinking it's like going to be some sort of online MMO-esque style game, I don't think it's that at all. Man, that might be part of the disconnect.
I agree.
Caller, you're on the line with After Dark. What's your name? Where are you from?
Hello, my name is Eduardo from Mexico.
Oh, this is Eduardo from Mexico. How are you, sir?
I'm fine. How are you, Gary?
Good. How you doing? We don't get to talk too much. You don't call anymore.
No, wait. Eduardo's calling. It's ad time. Ad time. Ad goes. Oh. Eduardo's corner. There we go. See? Right. See, this is how I remember to do ads, when Eduardo calls.
And then if he doesn't call, Shafton forgets. So
it's true.
Yeah.
Eduardo, hold the line, because I'm going to do an ad. Look how that works. Have you guys checked out Squarespace? If not, I ask you why. Everyone needs a website. Everybody's got a website. You got a guild? You probably need a website. You don't have one. You need one. if you're a person, just if you're a person, which I hope you are, there's probably a few aliens out there watching this show. But if you are a person on the internet, you probably need a website. Maybe you just want to put up your gaming videos. Maybe you want to, like, you know, repost your YouTube things, blog and vlog and do all that kind of stuff. And you need to build a website. Maybe you have no idea how to do that. I'm telling you, check out Squarespace. It is awesome. Not only for people who really don't know much about building a website, it's actually awesome for people who know a lot about building a website and actually coding, because you can really dig into it really deeply and make some killer, killer websites with this thing. It is no joke. The new engine on Squarespace is awesome. Most of it is all like what you see is what you get kind of stuff. Like, it's a lot of drag and drop. It's a lot of controls. You can do a lot of things with sliders. So all the things that used to take like coders where they'd have to sit and, you know, dial in and code HTML and all kinds of JavaScript and stuff, they have made, Squarespace has come along and they've made it super, super easy that you and I, the non-programmer, can absolutely make stuff. Look at this. See this? I mean, the days of, if you have a store, you want to sell stuff online, plugging in shopping cart software and things like that, telling you, not that easy to do. Be able to take credit cards, processing, get all this set up. They've got it all built in. It's all built into Squarespace now, and you can set up a store. It's so easy. We've got a great deal going on with them right now. I've been using Squarespace forever. Actually, the first Game Breaker website way back in the day, for you vets out there who are the old school hipsters out there, I made it on Squarespace because I had no idea what I was doing. And it was awesome because it got me through it and it built us a website and we were up and running. Check it out. I'm super happy to have these guys on as sponsors. We want to get you guys 10% off on your brand new account. Just go over to squarespace.com. On your checkout, you want to use the promo code GAMEBREAKER with the number 6, GAMEBREAKER 6. And we're going to give you guys 10% off on your account, which is really awesome. So check it out. Support Game Breaker by supporting our sponsors. Go over to squarespace.com today and use offer code GameBreaker6. All right. Thanks. Thanks so much, Eduardo, for queuing our sponsor break. Now that we've got that through, how are you? What is your question?
I'm fine. Well, why is Nintendo acting like a senile old man? Because...
What do you mean
by that? I don't know, Gary. Hey, Gary, why don't you tell us that? You got that answer? Why is Nintendo acting like you might have some insight? No? You make fun of me for being young, I'm making fun of you for being old. Get it? Uh-huh. No? All right. I'm going to go back to watching this stuff.
Because what's the point of being on E3 if they are not going to have a conference?
Sorry, I'm just going to... <a while. laughs> So what do you think? Why do you think they're being a senile? Like, do you think, are you saying that because that they didn't hold an E3 conference?
No, and they are doing like a Nintendo Direct instead, and that's something that you can do anytime. You are supposed to do a conference on E3.
I think Nintendo's honestly licking their wounds. I don't think they're, you know, the Wii U is selling at all as they expected it to. I don't think they're going to abandon the platform, but I don't think they necessarily have these big announcements. And correct me if I'm wrong, Gary, you know, E3 is kind of a new experience for me. There's gotta be a significant amount of cost involved for Nintendo to come in and really kind of push something like this out. So,
oh God, you know, E3, they're back to spending gajillions of dollars. You're going to see tomorrow when you hit the showroom floor, just looking at the booths, like you're looking at insane amounts of money. But I'm curious, Eduardo, like, so how do you see it as a gamer on the app? Like, why do you think that they're like not doing these things, or what's your take on it?
I am afraid that the Wii U is going to be Nintendo's Dreamcast.
The one that takes them under and knocks them out?
Yes. Yes, because I think they can't get away from with being weird this time. It worked for the Wii, but now everyone got motion control. Everyone got all the tricks that they did.
Well,
see, I have a hard time really kind of breaking down. Like, I have not. It's weird. I have not been a Nintendo console owner, and I cannot remember. Like, it's been so many years since I have. I don't know what he's going to find, but I'm not the demographic. I'm just not the demographic for the Nintendo platform anymore. There's nothing that really. I know you love Zelda.
See,
they always skewed for more of a younger audience. Maybe that younger audience. Maybe I don't know. Is it possible that maybe the is it possible that maybe the younger audience doesn't really watch E3 stuff like this? It's just like a big, like, you know, waste of money. But they'll the press. I don't know. I really don't. It's a really good question, Eduardo. I don't know why they're not doing anything. Maybe they just don't have anything in the pipeline and they're in like a sort of a, like you said, they're in a licking their wounds sort of like phase of the company. And maybe they're trying to redirect and figure out what to do next, but they don't really have anything to really talk about. It's like, well, why should we spend X millions of dollars to go out there and do this and really not have anything to talk about?
I mean, that's the thing is Nintendo is in this state of like, we don't have anything new to talk about. The thing is they hold their franchises so tight and close and don't do anything with them that it's just so like, I have these for a reason. This is the first one I ever got. This one I spent like 3 years trying to find.
Are those the ones you have to like? Yeah. Yeah.
Like, I mean, I hold on to these because obviously they're all Zelda, but like this is to me is Nintendo, is Zelda, and Nintendo to other people is Star Fox or Metroid. Nintendo has a very big fan base around specific titles, and they're not taking advantage of that. Like the Wii U at this year's E3, we didn't get it at launch last year. We had the little Zelda tech demo, and we need to hear about a new Zelda. We do. We absolutely do. Mario Brothers wasn't enough to really, I mean, Mario Brothers was what they kind of talked about last year. That was their big exciting news. We need to hear a Metroid. We need to hear a Zelda. We need something of their staples, because
Isn't it kind of sad that you're still waiting for those exact games, though? You're just like, we have to have a Zelda, and we have to have a Metroid, and it's like the same games I've been waiting for.
We got to have a Kingdom Hearts, and we got to have a Final Fantasy.
And it's like, I'm more excited, I got to say, and maybe this is part of the problem, is I'm more excited about Watch Dogs. And God, we didn't even talk about, what was the other game, Chatroom? Was it Origin 1886? And all these new IPs, like, maybe that's part of the problem. Like, maybe there's a lot less people who don't really care as much anymore.
These new IPs, I think, are sold by how grand they are in scale. Watch Dogs is crazy because of how great it looks and all these crazy features that you get to do. You know, The Crew, another great example of a game that blew me away. Nintendo's never pushed that. Nintendo's never pushed. They pushed innovation of gaming, but they've never pushed the idea of creating.
But how many? Right, exactly. My point is, how long can that be your model? How long could you not really like? They do some innovative stuff on their hardware side. Granted that, right, with like the stuff that they're doing, and even the Wii when it came out, like it was pretty innovative. But how long can you live and rest on those like those few core titles and IPs that everyone gets excited about? Right,
forever,
and they know that,
Gary, forever.
But they should have those, but they don't. There hasn't really been that much other stuff that's really broken out that people get super excited about. They're just waiting for those. Yeah. The other consoles, no, I feel like the other consoles have those still, and then they have some other stuff that also comes along with it. I don't know. Maybe they.
So, what do you think that's gonna do in terms of what going the way of the Dodo? Like Eduardo said, do you think that they're dooming themselves into extinction by not keeping up with the game?
No, I think Nintendo will be all right. I think it's all cyclical. I mean, it's even like with the console wars. It's like Microsoft won the 360. I mean, Microsoft won the 360 round, right? Which was the last round. And this year's Sony won the round. Maybe next year Nintendo will win the round. So it's like it's just a cyclical thing. It kind of goes in circles, and every year we get hyped up about a different company. It kind of like just goes around and around. It's not like every year one company's been knocking it out of the park where every year we're just like, this is it, this is it, this is it. It kind of kind of jumps around. Maybe Nintendo's gearing up and says, you know what? 2014 is our year. Like that's, and maybe they're probably planning that.
Well, I mean, what if Nintendo Direct, you know, we didn't see BlizzCon happen last year because they really had nothing to announce. What if Nintendo Direct is... And now, like, what if all they have to do is announce games and announce trailers? They don't need a huge E3 paid convention to get the idea, because all that stuff's going to be on game trailers, Game Breaker, all GameSpot. Like, all these trailers are going to exist online the second they are done playing on screen. So, like, if you don't have any necessarily hardware to show off, why make the trip if you only have visuals to show?
Do we know?
Just do it online.
I haven't even looked at the floor plan for tomorrow. Do we know, does Nintendo have a booth? I have to imagine that they're there. Like, they probably have a booth. And you're probably going to see the booth. They probably, when you see their booth, if it's the same booth that I saw the last time they were out, it's like a multi-million dollar booth. So basically, they may have cut the keynote out. But if they have the booth, even that thing is crazy. I don't know. It's hard to say. I've been slightly on a downer of a Nintendo. I got to be completely honest. I'm just not much of a Nintendo. I haven't bought one in a long, 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 long time. There's nothing that's motivating to me to buy one. Caller, you are on the line with After Dark. What is your name and where are you from?
Hey, Gary. It's Zista.
What's up, Zista? How's it going?
Just wanted to say in advance, thank you for the nightmares I'm going to have tonight by posting that picture of Shafton in his yellow dress on the screen.
Don't pretend like you haven't been wearing that dress.
No, absolutely not.
He lent
You've
it
got
to
a, you don't have that floral pattern.
No.
Shafton left it to Zista. Sorry, I apologize if you can't sleep tonight, but it had to be done.
I'm definitely not sleeping tonight after that.
What's your question?
Well, I've called in a few times now about the console war, and Mike has been defending Xbox every single chance he gets, but tonight he was very vocal on Twitter that he's jumped on the PS4 bandwagon. So I just
haven't been defending them.
You have. You have. Don't even. There's video evidence. You go back and watch all the After Darks. But all the announcements and blunders aside, would Kingdom Hearts 3 and Final Fantasy 15 be enough alone to have changed your mind?
Change my mind in terms of like purchasing it?
Leaning more toward, or yeah, being a PS3 fanboy instead of a Xbox fanboy.
See, I mean, I don't even consider myself to be a fanboy on either side of the spectrum here, but like, for me, I always just wanted to look at Xbox with kind of this objective side of things and not necessarily, and give them the benefit of the doubt to see what they did at E3. And like Gary said, until PlayStation came out and took punches at them, I wasn't really against the direction that Microsoft was going. So I don't necessarily know if I can say, like, for that alone, where I stand, because I don't think these swayed me. I can say for absolute certain that if either of these were to have ended up as console exclusives, I would have bought a PlayStation simply for that. I've bought two Nintendo Wiis for Zelda, for Skyward Sword and Twilight Princess. I bought my PlayStation 3 for Final Fantasy 13, and I bought my console for Halo and shooters. I'm very much an impulse buyer of like, if there's one game I want to play, I'll spend $500 on the console and then never touch it again.
I think so.
I am a fanboy. Come on, everybody knows I'm a fanboy, especially of these two. Like,
hey,
we love games. I rant about how awesome Kingdom Hearts is. And
this is why when I take sides, I just say I'm a PC gamer. And then there's no other side to take because all the PC gamers just rally behind you and just go like, yes, he's a PC gamer. And there's no competition. You're just a PC gamer. I got no one to put it up against. I'm still an Xbox fan, I got to say, even though they're blundering. You know what's weird?
Why?
Well, I don't know. Well, I do know why. Because I guess if I look at the last cycle of it's hard to say that, like, you know, this new cycle is going to be like the last cycle, but I have to say in the past, traditionally, I have used my Xbox and had much more of an enjoyable time, much more than my PlayStation 3. My Xbox is sitting right here off camera, hooked up to a television next to me. It's ready to go. My PS3 is in the back, not hooked up. So PS2 is like a little bit different, but like I say, go ahead.
This is even the support for the Xbox. I think this plays into the very distinct routes that PlayStation and Xbox went for their marketing. Xbox is used much more as a media hub, much more than just a gaming platform. People use it, and even though PlayStation said that they're the number one Netflix thing, I definitely feel like I get more of a robust experience out of my Xbox. However, when I turn on my PlayStation, even though I have this wonderful app that lets me save pictures and bring it up for my TV and an internet browser and even a friends list, like, that's gone. That's dead to me. I strictly turn my PlayStation on to push the game in and play the game. The moment the game's over, it's off.
The other stuff does not have a great experience. I agree. The thing was, traditionally, like, the Xbox has had more games that, like, are my type of games. I like more shooters, you know, in the past and things like that, a little bit more like that. The PlayStation has gone to some of the other... I'm not a huge, like, I don't really play the Kingdom Hearts games even. Like, even some of the Final Fantasy stuff, I played some of the early ones. I'm probably gonna play this one. I'll play Versus. I will. But like I said, if you look at the last, the reason why I'm still holding out with Xbox is just because, well, you know, at the end of the day, I definitely purchased and played and enjoyed more games on my Xbox 360 than I did on my PS3. So is that going to completely change because they knocked it out of the park at a keynote? I don't know. Let's not forget, keynotes are smoke and mirrors. Like, you know, they're showing games and they are real games, but let's be honest, like, your speakers are on, they got that magic, they catch that fire on stage, people start cheering. Like, you can get emotionally caught up in a keynote very easily. And you come away from it and you're like, yes. Like, they did kill it. They killed it. They built up the energy. They got it. People got behind them. We did at home. So I'm not saying, like, those feelings aren't real and what they're showing isn't real. I'm just saying, hey, I loved my 360. So I'm not going to totally just turn on it and just be like, I'm not going to get you 360 because, you know,
Gary's team 360. Gary's team 360.
I'll go team 360. Stated. There you go. I'll go to the other side. I love the console wars. Love it. Can we start a debate show on GameBreaker TV? Just debating the console wars. That's it. Every week.
It would just turn into yelling.
Just two people just debate just every week. Games on each. All right. Last caller of the night. You are on After Dark. What is your name? Where are you from?
Hey, guys. It's Kyle from Rhode Island. I guess.
Hey, Kyle. How's it going?
Good. How you guys doing?
Excellent. You excited for E3?
Yeah, it's the first one that I've really been into in a long time.
It's the fun, Super Bowl, right? For video games.
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun.
Especially when you get online. I actually love it online. I don't want to go to the keynotes, like, live. I go online. I'd rather sit with the chat room, watching them, like, chat and talk in game. I'm like, it's awesome. People get all behind it. They get all pumped up. When Tesso came up, people were just like, holy shit! People were just, like, losing their minds. You saw the logo behind him, and it was like, sorry, I'm sidetracking.
I gotta agree with you, though, real quick. I think I like, even this is with this being my first opportunity to go, I think the keynotes are just more fun to experience online. You get better camera angles. You actually get, like, full screen video game footage. You get the chat room.
The fun is going to be tomorrow, hitting the floor, getting your hands on stuff, getting to play some stuff. Sorry, I digress. What was your question?
Sorry. So my question is, after seeing that the PS4 will allow used games and the X-Clone not allowing it, the debate of used games hurt developers and the gaming community kind of comes back up into play. Whose philosophy is right, Microsoft or Sony?
I mean, if you're looking at it from a monetary standpoint, it definitely doesn't help developers. Like, they don't see a penny of that. So it doesn't necessarily help them. That's for sure. I mean, you could kind of make the argument and just say, like, more people are playing your game, but I don't know. It's tough being on the other side when this is your livelihood and you spend years of your life making it and you're trying to make a career out of this. And then you do know that money that kind of, you know, in a large sense of the word, like, you sort of possibly deserve in some respect, or at least a cut of that, is you're kind of cut out of it. So I don't know, but the other side of this is, like, we've also lived in a culture and society that has kind of allowed this forever, right? It goes back to, like, music, even. They've allowed, like, buying records, selling records. CDs came, you could buy CDs, sell CDs. So it's like, you can't change it. We're just used to that. So for them to try and just be like, no, you cannot do this anymore, there will be no trading, there will be no used games, is I think absolutely insane for them. So I don't agree with them doing it because I think they're nuts and I think they're being somewhat arrogant, just like the music industry was. And that's when the music industry was just like, you know what? F you guys. I'll just go to Pirate Bay and download all this stuff. And then they were like, holy crap, this whole pirating thing really is catching on. And the average person is learning how to do it. And now we're making no money. And then they were like, maybe we need to rethink this thing and just maybe try and sell it and make some money. So
I don't think there's a clear answer. This is a question that splits you right down the moral line of whether you think that, because as Gary said, the developers aren't seeing a penny from a resold game. A perfect example is the first time I played and beat BioShock, I took it from work. It had no intention of really buying it. It was just I would wait a month to play it and just play the work copy. And then I played it. It was so amazing that I immediately felt the moral decision that they deserved my money and went and paid for it. But not everybody's that way. And that's essentially exactly why this is kind of being enforced. They could have been, taken out of a sale just based on the fact that I borrowed a work copy. And that isn't fair to the developer. They're not selling as much as what they should have, especially because I didn't just try the game. I didn't try it for an hour and put it down and be like, I went all the way to the end. And especially with a game like BioShock where there's no replayability, as much, they're not going to get me to truly go out and buy the game after I already beat it unless I felt the way that I did that I wanted to give them the money. So
where is it called? Where do you stand on the whole thing?
I think you hit it, the nail on the head where you said that it's wrong, I think, for Microsoft to just say you can't do it. But I'm also from like the school of thought where I don't buy used games anymore. I used to. Even now, I'll just set aside money. If I know a game I want to buy it, I'm going to buy it new to support the developers. I think it's with everyone, especially now, right, going on right now, where people are like, yo, I'm a Sony fanboy or an Xbox fanboy or the three people that are Nintendo fanboys. I think it's more important to support the developers. I think if you're an Ubisoft fanboy or a Blizzard fanboy, then they see that money, they get the chance to take more chances when they're coming up with games, and you get to see new, cooler IPs with things that you may not have seen before.
Yeah, and again, but the flip side of that is we live in a society and a culture that kind of has felt like we're given the right to be able to buy a physical item and then resell a physical item. I can do it with almost anything, right? I bought this monitor, yeah. I can sell it to you. So it's like we're just so used to that. I just don't know if you can fight it. I think maybe fighting it as hard as Microsoft is trying to, where they're literally just like locking it down and like putting padlocks and everything, I don't think that's the answer.
Yeah, I agree. I think you're right. Like you can't just say no. You have to allow.
I'll keep going back to the music industry, and I'll just keep saying like they tried to do this just a few short years ago when the whole transition, when everything started transitioning out of like compact discs and CDs going over to digital. They all tried to do this, and it didn't work. It just didn't work, and they've all had to figure out different ways to make money, including musicians. Right, musicians probably got hurt the most. They probably saw huge decreases in how much they would make a year, and that sucks. But you know what? Mm-hmm. It's the way it kind of goes, right? And they had to figure out other ways to make money, and maybe they had to tour more and sell more t-shirts and this, that, and the other. And so I don't fully agree with it, but at the same time, I don't think Microsoft is going about it the right way. Shafton agrees.
I agree. Yeah. I mean, it's like I said, from it's a moral thing. It's they're not wrong for wanting to set up law and structure. But there's no telling to what, I mean, and this isn't going to change. This is going to happen. So I think what's really kind of cool is going to see where the hacking community takes this, because we could get some really cool add-on jailbroken Xboxes out of this.
And exactly what you just said right there. That is exactly what will happen. They will figure out how to jailbreak it. They will make it super easy, and the average Joe will do it, and it makes it all worse. So Mike Shafnit, follow him on Twitter, Mike Shafnit. Come right here every Tuesday for After Dark, where he usually sits in the chair that I'm sitting in, which he will be back next week, even if I'm here and in the closet. He's just going to stare at those and think about it.
I'm going back to my research, right? Okay.
That's it. Got to research. Follow me at Gary Gannon. You can follow Gamebreaker TV, Gamebreaker TV. We got another contest going. You guys have to enter. It's awesome. Go over to facebook.com/GamebreakerTV. We have a screenshot contest going on. So post a screenshot of any game you like, the best screenshot you have. Doesn't matter what game it is. And then we're letting the users vote on the screenshot. So whatever you guys vote on, the winner. The winner will win a Razer Naga. And then five runners up will win GameBreaker t-shirt. So go over, that's on the Facebook page. Or if you go to GameBreaker TV, there should be a banner there. Click it and you could go there as well. So check that out. Sponsors. Give a last one. Go to Netflix. We love Netflix. Another one of our sponsors. Go to Netflix.com/GameBreakerTV. Sign up for a free 30-day trial. And keep an eye on GameBreaker all week. We've got E3 coverage coming starting tomorrow. So we'll be on the showroom floor. Look for interviews, demos, all that good stuff will be posted up daily. So keep checking back all day. Guys, thanks so much for watching. Truly appreciate it. Hope you guys had fun. Day one of E3. And we'll see you next time and some more After Dark. Thanks.